Oh, okay. Okay. Well, my dad, Anthony Lee Sr., has been preaching as far as I've been alive. So there's a few times where I'm able to introduce my dad, but I love him so much, and he's definitely my rock and what I've been doing with school, and my mother as well, who wasn't able to be here. But just with my whole journey and having that support, because a lot of people don't have support these days from their family. And so for us to be so connected and helping me build my foundation has been very beneficial in my life, and will continue to be that way. So here's my dad.
Can we give God a hand clap of praise? You know, as a father, those are some of the sweetest words that you can have or hear, is your child serving God and to see the progress that God has done in her life. So I give God glory for what he has done in the life of Angelica. And I'm so excited about, I'm proud of her. She's my oldest daughter. I have three, and then a son. But when she decided that she wanted to come to ORU, I was very, really confident that God was going to do some major things in her. And she came down to ORU into Tulsa, a girl, but is coming back a woman of God. And just so really happy about what God is doing through her. And I could not be more proud of what God has done through her. The instruments that God has used to help mold her, in addition to her school, are the angels of the house here. Apostle, pastor, bishop, Jane, I know he doesn't like that, but James Hill, who has blessed so many men and women of God across the country. Many well-known individuals have come through Northside on their journey. And I think it would be very, very appropriate at this time if we would just stand and give God a big praise for Pastor James and Marilyn Hill. Can we put our hands together and just celebrate them? Come on. Celebrate them. Thank you. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Come on, one more time. Do a little bit better. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. Pastor Hill, I've known him all my life as well. Our families have been connected since I can remember. He's always been a man of God, a man of prayer, a man of humor, and got a chance to even know him a lot better with me coming down here a few times a year and spending time with him. We often have talks on the phone, and we laugh and we talk about whatever we need to talk about. And then we go in, and he's preaching to me, and he's releasing word to me, and we just go in and have sometimes long conversations, 45 minutes to an hour. And I appreciate who he is in my life and in the body of Christ, as well as his family. And Kim, my friend, many years ago, who is now back in Tulsa, I praise God for her, and Derek and Rodney, the entire family. We bless the Lord for them. And I'm just going to tell you that pray for your first family. Pray for them, because God is doing great things in their lives. And so I'm just excited to be here. And I also want to extend gratitude for the opportunity to come and minister to you today. I don't count it lightly to preach here. This is a place that has had many, many great speakers and many preachers that have ministered here. But I'm not a stranger to this house, so I'm excited today to release a word to you. As the worship was going forth this morning, and there was a moment in there when I sensed warfare. And when Sister Brianna hit, there was a couple of notes. There is, tap a neighbor and say, there's a sound. There was a moment when I just felt something break inside of me. And I began to just cry and worship the Lord. When you're battling and you're trying to do what God has called you to do, and many times there is something that is withstanding you. And this is not my message, but this is just some nuggets. And Daniel had prayed and prayed and prayed, and had asked God, God, why is it taking so long? And God has sent the archangel Michael to assist Gabriel, because the Bible said the prince of Persia had withheld him had stood between him and his answer. And how many of you all have been praying for some things and waiting for God to do some things, but there has been an enemy, come on, that has seemingly blocked the path? But I want to let you know today, I believe that God is going to give us some solutions. Amen. Some solutions to deal with these things and the delays and all the things that comes about. And the enemy that you're facing and the enemy that you're battling, God is going to show you how to take control of your enemy. Is that all right? Tap a neighbor and say, I want to take control of my enemy. Amen. If you have your Bibles, can we go to the book of Proverbs and rise to your feet? Proverbs chapter number 16, verse 7. Amen. If you will rise to your feet in honor of the word of the Lord. I also honor God for my wife of 27 years who is not here, but is tending to family matters, as one's going ready to go to college and then one is going further in his career. But praise God for Zaretta Lee. Amen. The seventh verse of chapter 16. When a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. I'm going to read a couple other verses just so we can put a wrap, a bow on it. Better is a little with righteous than great revenues without right. A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directed his path. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we bless your name and we thank you for who you are. We rely totally upon you. This is your service. These are your people. And as a vessel, I pray that you would think through my mind and speak through my lips, that it would be clear, and all the inefficiencies that I have, God, that you would just rise through those and minister to your people. We thank you for the anointing that is in this place that even began in the prayer and in the Sunday school and all the things that have taken place today. But God, I pray through this word, God, that you would release your power and release, God, a great understanding and empower us, God, and equip us as we do battle against the kingdom of darkness. And we give you praise and we give you honor and glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Just look at the neighbor and say, taking control of your enemies. As I was just pondering and looking at this particular scripture that I have quoted many times, and I've heard it, amen, preached and ministered, but the Lord began to deal with me about the enemies that we're facing today. The enemy that we're facing today as we walk and try to carry out the assignment and the call of God upon our lives. And we do a lot of different things, and we many times go through a lot of motions, but there's a scripture, amen, that says, amen, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. And as I have had my travels of preaching, ministering, and visiting many houses of worship and dealing with many Christians across the country, my heart is saddened because I am absolutely seeing a dividing in the body of Christ of the wheat and the tare, and a dividing between those who desire to walk in light versus those who, amen, want to play around in darkness and run in the light. Am I talking to somebody? And because of this, I have began to talk to God about some things that I've seen and things that just don't understand, because many of the ways of the word has been left, and many of the old paths that have been set, amen, regarding the word of God and the establishment of the word of God have been left. And so the very foundation that I want to lay this morning with you, amen, is found in the book of Hebrews, and then we're going to come and wrap everything together. But the Bible says that without faith, it is impossible to please God. One of the first points I want to talk about, and this is the whole theme of this message, is pleasing God.
Yes.
Look at the neighbor and say, pleasing God.
Please God.
And to please really simply means according to Webster's, is to make feel happy or to satisfy, to bring pleasure, to bid the call or to carry out an assignment that one has asked him to do with joy. And so the Bible says when a man's ways please God, he will make even the enemies to be at peace with him. How many of you all are dealing with enemies? We're dealing with things that are obstacles and all kinds of things that are blocking us and buffeting us, and sicknesses and poverty and time delays, all of these things. But the first place of foundation, beloved, is in Hebrews. Amen. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. When we talk about faith, we're not just talking about believing in a God, believing, amen, that God has created the world, but believing in the word that God has established in the earth, amen, for mankind, but also about your life. Having the faith and believing that what God has said about you and for you and what he wants to do through you has already been established in heaven. But when we have things that will stand before us, many times our faith will get weak, or we will, amen, begin to doubt and not really believe. But we have to be established, number one, that God's word is right. We're in a season and time when the word of God is under an assault. The word of God is on Tabernacle, and the word of God is under assault. There are people that are battling the word, amen. They're battling scriptures, trying to take the word apart scripture by scripture, amen, and trying to get the believers to question the very basis and principle of what we stand on. And I have heard of those ministers and some who are rising up and they're preaching heresy and declaring, amen, that this in the word of God doesn't mean what it says, and that it's okay to have same-sex marriage, come on, and all of the different things that they're now trying to include, amen, and say that God is honoring it. But here is where the problem is that with all of these things that's happening and more people going to church now than ever before, but we're seeing more violence and more crime in our communities than ever before. We're seeing more infighting in families, but yet all across America, churches are packed out with people, amen, trying or attempting to worship God in their own way. Isaiah 55 says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways. For the heavens are higher than earth, so are my ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. The Bible also declares that there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. I heard the woman of God as she was singing this morning, talking about lifting up a hand and surrendering. One of the things that has to happen to please God, amen, along with faith, is a place and a position of surrendering. Surrendering to God, your will, your way, because each season that you go into, there has to be a brand new surrender. Each place, each position, each level. Some people say, I want to go to the next level, but in your next level, there has to be a yes. In your next level, you're going to be faced with temptations. You're going to be faced with opportunities. You're going to be faced with situations that may cause you to take a step back, to begin to self-indulge. But there has to be a place of self-surrender. Our greatest example is the Lord Jesus Christ. God said this. He said, this is my son in whom I am well pleased. He has to be the prime example that we use when we watch the life of Christ. Amen. Jesus would go about doing great things and miracles. And then the Bible says, and he would get alone to go on Facebook. He would get alone to post a status. He'd get alone to get on Twitter. Come on. He'd get alone to go shopping. The Bible says Jesus would get alone to pray. Now, if Jesus is God in the flesh, but he was living out an example and letting us understand that you don't walk this walk by yourself, but you walk this walk in the grace of God by your surrendering and by your prayer time with God. Now, prayer has even been fought because people talk about what we do is babbling. And this don't make sense, amen, when we began to go into points of lifting up our hands or swinging our hands, began to wave our hands or speaking in other tongues or running. But it is, come on, it is an example of what God is doing many times in the spirit realm to your enemy. But now they say, don't take all that. We come in church and we're in for an hour and 15 minutes so you can run and go to Walmart and Texas Roadhouse, come on, and Biagi's and all the great restaurants that we go to. We'll just take a few moments in church. Because they don't understand, and people don't understand, amen, that it takes, amen, something being released inside of you to deal with what's going on outside of you. We want to quote word and say, the Bible says, great is he that was inside of me than he that's in the world. Now, in the name of Jesus, loose it. And you're saying something out of your mouth, and you don't have the back of you on the inside. It's like writing a check to go pay for something, but there's nothing in the bank to back up that $5,000 that you want to pay for that particular item. Having a check is not enough. Saying I'm saved is not enough to deal with these enemies that you face. A lot of people are frustrated. They're wearing the pastors out all across the land. Pastors are retiring at early ages because they're getting wore out, because people feel like once I accept the Lord in my life, then everything is up to the pastors will preach me into glory. They will preach me into healing. Come on. They will preach me into prosperity. They will preach me into peace. So we use church as a crutch or even as a drug. Because if you're not lifting up hands in the house, if tears can't flow in the house, don't expect no peace in the house. When the enemy comes to your house, you can't get on the phone and call pastor and prayer partner all the time, but there's got to be something inside of you that allows you to deal with your enemy. So the Bible says, when a man's ways please God, what does it mean to please God? It means to run after God and forsake everything else. Well, Pastor, this is 2017. Don't you understand? Herein lies the issue, is that you and I have to deal with more distractions today than folks had to deal with 10 and 15 years ago. When I was coming up, we didn't have cell phones. We didn't have Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all the other chats. And we're always finding out and want to know what everybody else is saying and take little time to find out what God has said in his word. Am I in the house this morning? I'm not going to be long. The Bible says when a man's ways please God. The first thing has to happen is that you have to understand that God is. He that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently go after him, diligently run after him, diligently seek him, diligently lay aside, amen, their ambitions and run after God. Tap a neighbor and say, you gotta run after God. Songwriter wrote a song the other day, or some years ago, said, I'm chasing after you. Yes. A writer wrote a book called The God Chaser. And many of us, amen, have forgotten, amen, because of the challenges of life, what it took to get us here. But it will take more than that to go to the next level. Because to get into this season, it's going to take more to get into your next season. Yes. Glory. You gotta have faith in God's plan, in God's word. Man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of his mouth. I don't care what anybody else says or what anybody else thinks about the matter. If God has said it in his word, I believe his word. I don't care, amen, I don't have to know, amen, where it came over in London and King James and this and that. A lot of folks get caught up in all of that stuff, amen, and don't really understand that the power of the word works. You don't have to be a theologian and run the school, because folks want to debate about all these things. I see it on Facebook and see them debating about it and fussing about it. It's big time down here in Tulsa, you know what I'm talking about. And the problem is that people are forgetting that there's power in the word of God. See, there's testimonies all over this room of people that couldn't live right, couldn't get things together, but they had an encounter with God. And in that encounter, things began to change.
So I'm here to tell you today that faith in God's plan, faith in God's way and will. Many times God may allow delay to come in your life. That's not the time to begin to have self-pity and look out and wonder why somebody else got blessed and you didn't get blessed. I can imagine somebody else may have been in that same situation. Thank you. And this sister that got her breakthrough and got what she needed. And you may be saying, boy, I've been waiting for the same thing. Now, what about me? I'm telling you this. When your ways please God, whatever may be delaying it, it's going to have to move together. Because you're laying it all down at the altar. It's another thing. Folks don't believe in the altar anymore. But I believe in those old paths, amen, of getting on your knees. We've been to different churches, and you visit, and you're going to these churches, and it's amazing. Amen. And, I'm not against the lights and the this and the that, but sometimes we have so many things that make you comfortable. In church, can I come down here for a minute? We get so comfortable in church, we got coffee in the lobby. We get Tootsie Rolls and cookies. Bring our soda and our coffee in the church. And that's all good because we're trying to reach the seeker generation. They're in the churches and they're still looking. They're still looking. They're still debating in their mind whether they're gonna go here, and I think I'm gonna go to a Muslim church tomorrow, to a mosque. I think next week I'm gonna visit. And some of these folks been in church for a long time, but they are not convinced about God's word because they don't see no power. The letter kill it, but the spirit make it alive. You can get up there and you can preach or teach a message, but if there's no anointing in it, these are just mere words on the page. God has taken the word, amen, and caused men who were under inspiration to write the word of God out, but then he anointed men and women of God who would lay in his presence, seek God's face, cry out, go through storms, lose everything, and get up and begin to exegete and preach the word of God. And it is through the foolishness of preaching that you walk in jacked up and walk out right side up. Come on, somebody ought to give God some praise. I'm talking about going back to the patterning of the word of God. I'm disturbed as an evangelist area of my assignment in this season of life of what I'm seeing. We got to now stir up in the house and tell you, stop trying to take a shortcut to the blessing. We want to say, I'm pregnant with purpose. How many of y'all ever been around pregnant people? At first, there's a lot of excitement because there's a promise. But then there's the morning sickness. I can't get no help here. My sisters need to help me here. There comes some morning sickness. There comes some, this don't fit no more. I got to go to the store. Some readjustment of what you're wearing. I can't get no help here. Some things that you used to eat. I know people that were smoking can't smoke no more because it would damage the baby. Changing of habits that they didn't think they could change. But because they love the baby, they make changes. I'm pregnant, Pastor. But yet everything remains the same in your life. Not so. When you're pregnant with something, there's changes that come. You don't run as fast after you ran because you're carrying something. You don't stay up and stay out late. You don't put the baby in danger because you're carrying. Anybody that's carrying something. When you're carrying something, amen, you protect what you carry. So I'm telling you this one thing, that when it comes to God and the seasons in God and the timing of God and his plan for your life, amen, you got to understand that I want to please God, so I want to do things that will cause God to take joy in my life. Yes. Ask yourself a question. Can God look at your life and say that he's pleased with where you are? Now I hear those theologians that will say, now brother preacher, now you're trying to get into works. It's not by works, but it's by grace. And I know it is. Yes. But the Bible says faith without works is dead. Yes, God. Yes, God. There should be some signs. Come on. Yeah. of the joy of the Lord in your life. There should be some signs of the peace of God in your life. When the enemy comes in front of you, the enemy should not always see panic when he pushes a button. You've been in the way of God for some years and in the season of God, and you've seen God work, amen, and now he comes in around the corner. And when these things happen in our lives and pastors' lives and members' lives, we all have to do the same thing. Submit ourselves unto God. Yes. Resist the devil. Come on, somebody. And he's going to flee from you. I thank you, Holy Ghost. I heard the Lord say, this is what you got to do. Is you have to submit yourself, but you have to be acquainted with this big Bible that you carry around. Look at a neighbor and tell him it's not a souvenir. You don't need to dust it. But that word I pulled out, I've never preached out of this Bible. It's a brand new Bible. And my wife was saying, honey, make sure you can see out of that Bible because you need readers and you're trying to be cool. You don't have progressives. So I'm always taking off these things because these words are so little. But my other Bible, if I brought it, it has markings all in it. Writing in red, blue, yellow, clearing out things, writing out things, what God is saying. You have to get the word of God inside you. The devil's not afraid of your church affiliation, your denomination affiliation, who your best friend is, or who your pastor is. He is only afraid of how big the Jesus is on the inside of you. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God will lift up a standard against it. It's not always on the outside, it's inside of you. God will change you in the situation. Many times we're waiting for God to change things and shift this and, you know, fix my husband, Jesus, fix my children, fix my this, that, and the other. But God's been trying to deal with you in the arena of patience. He's been trying to deal with you in the arena of fruit of the Spirit, because a lot of folks want to talk about their prophetess, prophet. Come on, and having all of the gifts of the Spirit, but don't understand that in order for the gifts of the Spirit to operate, you have to have fruit. Because you eat off of this. Gifts you give away. And many times people give all the gifts away, but then have nothing else to eat for themselves because they don't have no fruit. You gotta have, tap on everything, you gotta have some fruit operating in your life. When God sees you, can he see some fruit in your life? You might say, well, Pastor, why do you say that? Well, when Jesus was going and he was hungry, the Bible says he went by and he saw a tree. And he knew that was a fig tree. And what his expectation was for that fig tree to be producing what it was. Be producing figs. And when it didn't produce figs, there was no figs, and it was in the season to produce. Tap a neighbor and say, there comes a time when you got to produce. Jesus came by and didn't see no figs, and he got upset. Yes. And a lot of folks, well, Jesus had an attitude. No, he understood that that tree should have been producing at this point. Yes. And because it didn't produce, he said, you have no good. I did not call you to be a lily. I called you to be a fig tree. You're not supposed to be beautiful. You're supposed to feed people. I can't get no help in here. So because there was no fig, he said, there is no longer any purpose for you because you are refusing to produce figs. And he cursed it and kept moving. Disciples came back a little bit later. He walked by and said, Master, Master, look, the tree that you cursed is gone. Jesus was a bad man. He walked in power. He walked in authority. Come on. And he didn't wait. He said what he had to say and kept moving. Sometimes you got to rebuke the devil and say, I declare that there's going to be peace, and go to your job and stop using all your vacation leave. Speak a word and go to work. I can't get no help here. Sometimes you got to tell the devil, devil, I rebuke in the name of Jesus. I have 4 more hours of sick leave. I need my check. In the name of Jesus, as I go, I will be healed. And get up and get in your car and make a move. And healing will be out. That's what faith is. Faith is calling those things which be as though it was. Then God looks and says, that person is actually operating my word and not just looking at it. So sometimes God allows things to come in our life to see what we're going to do with what has been released inside of us. God is not pleased just by us coming to church. God is not pleased by us putting on our nice suits and clothes and coming to church. That's fine. It may show how God has blessed your life, but it comes about how you deal with enemies. So the latter part of my message that I want to just say, look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, you have to now face the bullies in your life. A lot of us have had, amen, the spirit of deferment, where we defer things off. Come on, y'all know how you to get a bill and you defer it off. I can't deal with it now, but I'll deal with it later. But then when that later comes, you gotta address it. And I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, now you gotta address some things. There are enemies in your life, and you got to stop saying what God needs to do and begin to understand, is my life lining up with the Word of God? Am I trying? Am I making a, am I making effort to follow God's word, will, and way? Bible says that we will be strong in God and we will be able to do exploits. But we don't see that as much in this season. For those seers and prophets and prophetesses of God, you can understand there are things happening in certain parts of the world. But in America, we are in a sudden spiritual lull. We're having church, but folks are, it's like pulling teeth. Am I talking to anybody that understands what I'm saying? The spirit, you understand? I mean, it's kind of like, man, God, where are you? What's going on? And it is because there is coming some challenges in America and coming in our country that's going to drive us back to our knees. Tap a neighbor and say, you ain't seen nothing yet. But what's going to happen if there is no health care? What the saints going to do then? You don't need to be running in nobody's line at that point. The Bible says, if there's any sick among you, let them for the... Look at David and say, every problem, God has a solution. If the doctor shut up, I don't run afraid. I know a God that can dissolve tumors. That can, come on somebody, that can dissolve growths. Come on somebody. I know a God that can operate without cutting you open. Oh, I heard, there was so much in that worship today that I heard, I have no fear. I have no reason to fear. Tell me, say, I have no fear. I have no fear because God's word has already set an answer to every enemy that will ever face my life. But I have to be in position, come on somebody, and in a mind condition to believe it. No reason for anybody to be upset who's in the White House. Because as long as God hasn't gotten kicked out of heaven, why are we worrying about who's in the White House? Who's in the State House? Who's the mayor? God will operate with the enemy sitting in the chair. God can still move and operate. Sometimes you have to limit your media consumption. And you got to turn on some fake preachers and better yet open up the Word of God and lay in the Word of God and just begin to speak and begin to say, amen, amen. If God be for me, who can be against me? Hallelujah. No weapon that's formed against me can prosper. Let me just give you a quick testimony. I was on my way to Tulsa and I fly all over the place, but this is the first time in all my years of flying. I mean, she's laughing at me. Man, don't say that. I got on this plane and it was literally from here to about here on the inside. It was a little plane, and my daughter got my ticket. Dad, you gotta get here and get me. You gotta get me here and get me. So she got my ticket and had me fly. I don't know where the geography was with this traveling here. Got me fly from Orlando to Chicago. Had 15 minutes to get off my plane from gate, y'all know how big that airport, from gate B and run to C. I was sweating hot. And got on, and I came into this little hot plane that's gonna fly for two and a half hours. I was like, Lord Jesus, I was beginning to pray. And I sat in my seat. Sister Kim, I was in the jump seat. I was on the side. I was on the side that if something happens to the plane, then I'm the one that's gotta pull the airbag down. Help and open up the door. But on this plane, began to fly, and the devil began to talk to me. He said, you've set some things in order, you've done this, and you began to do some things, and all the family's coming back together. And he said, I'm gonna take you down, because this plane started literally shaking. I mean, this plane was jumping and shaking and carrying on, jumping all over the place. And as I was sitting in there, I had to rebuke the thoughts of the enemy. Because he said, you know, he started telling me different preachers who had died in accidents. David Wilkerson died in a car accident. Miles Monroe died in a plane. He was just talking to my mind. And for a moment, I was sitting up there having dialogue. I felt something rise up on the inside of me. Come on, and just tell the devil, devil, you are a liar. God still has assignment for me. I ain't going out of here. I began to say in the name of Jesus, straighten this plane, because this thing was jumping. And we said, the whole time we had our seatbelts on. And I began to say, in the name of Jesus, I was pleading the blood. Somebody was over looking at me, and I said, in the name of Jesus. They looked at me. They said, we need something to happen. Well, I began to think that we can take control in the air. How many of y'all know there are enemies that have your name on it? Just like blessings have your name on it. If you don't know how to act in a storm, can I tell you about Jesus? When he was teaching his disciples, the first storm they were on, Jesus was on the boat. And they had a storm. Yes. And he said, Jesus, Master, wake up, we're about to perish. Yes. And he walked out on the deck, said, oh, your little faith. He said, peace be still. Yes. But a while longer, later, tap name and say, next level. Next level. Next level. Say, next level. Next level. Then he says, disciples, I want you to go out to the other side. Get in the boat, go out to the other side. Jesus went alone to pray. Yes. This time God tells him, don't wait for your disciples to come to you. Now, Jesus, be Jesus. Look at him and say, sometimes you have to tell Jesus to be Jesus. He got out and began to walk on the water. And the Bible says he was walking on the water and he was walking toward his disciples and they were in a storm. The waves were blowing violently and the wind. And when they saw him, they thought he was a ghost or a spirit. When God comes and begins to move in your life, he may come a different way than you're used to. Stop equating everything to the devil. Oh, I lost half of y'all with that. Because Jesus came walking to them, and they were like, oh, it's a ghost. Because that's where their condition and their faith level was. Jesus had already prepared them first for the storm, being on the boat. I'm trying to help you here. The next storm that they had, Jesus wasn't in their proximity. But tap a neighbor and say, but he was still there. So then he walks up to them. And that's what Peter says, Lord, if it's you, if it's you, they knew what Jesus looked like, but he's like, but this is crazy, you're walking on the water. I don't, come on, if it's you. Now he had rubbed shoulders with Jesus. He was going to let it cut off the ear for somebody with Jesus. This guy knew who Jesus was. But he's like, Lord, if it's you, tell me to get out of where I'm at. Tell me to get out of the vehicle that's carrying me in the storm and get and come to you. Now, Jesus could have said, no, it's not necessary. I'm coming to you. But Jesus said, no, get out of the boat that's carrying you, that's being tossed, and walk to me. Tap my name and say, next dimension. The enemies that face your life propel you to your next position of power. The devil may first fight you with a headache. They may fight you with chest palpitations, heartache, and then start going up levels. And when he starts to do that, God has already delivered you from one and will deliver you from them all. Peter gets out and he walks on the water. Now check this out. The other disciples, as we know the story, didn't get out. You gotta separate yourself from the crowd when it comes to pleasing God. Yes. It was pleasing Jesus for Peter to get out of the boat. Yes. And he had the faith. The Bible says that they had planned their ways. In that scripture we read earlier, that we orchestrate our ways, but God will plan them or will redirect them. Yes. Peter didn't, there was no plan for Peter to walk on water. There was no insurance on that boat for Peter to get out of the boat. He gets out and he walks toward Jesus. But then when he takes his eyes off Jesus and looks down at what is holding him, sometimes we're looking at our job. That is not your source. You need to say it loud and clear in America. My job is not my source, it is only a resource. If you lose your job, you don't all of a sudden all out of your mind say, oh man, we're not gonna be able to make the payment. See, that don't please God. I wrote in my notes when I was in prayer, when we were doing worship tonight, and the Lord just brought it back to my remembrance. Believers have to be disciplined with their mouth. You cannot move off emotion. We are emotional creatures, but your emotions have to be used, amen, to empower the fruit of the Spirit, not the gifts of the Spirit. When you get in a tight situation, you cannot go human, you gotta go spiritual. Oh Lord, have mercy. People around you are gonna look at you crazy because you're gonna do crazy things. Because that's who our God is. He is not limited to the natural elements, Pastor Moore. He's not limited. That's why intercessory prayer, amen, you're praying now, amen. Your prayer now may be the thing that propel you in your next season of trial, test, and when you don't even have the strength to pray. But you pray, God, I don't hear somebody. You pray before Jesus always prayed. He always talked to God. He commanded things to be in order. So when he came in a position of operation, he didn't have to go and say, Lord, this is Anthony calling you. Remember me? I live at 7225. I know I haven't talked to you in 10 days. Forgive me for this. Forgive me for that. Forgive me for the other. I hope you will. I believe you will.
Yes, Lord.
That sounds like somebody that's trying to reintroduce themselves to God. Let me just drop this in you. You know the scripture that says in Matthew where it says, I prophesied in your name, I cast out demons in your name. But he said, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you. That new means I never had an intimate relationship with you. You never came beyond the veil. I know you. You know when folks say, and we don't say anybody say, oh yeah, I dated. No, I didn't have, we didn't go there. There's something that is reserved for marriage that shouldn't be partaken in dating. Hello. You don't know your girlfriend when you're dating her. Oh, I'm in the wrong church right here. Because folks do it all now. They live and they try it out and determine whether they want to, you know, does this sock smell? Come on. Whatever, I can't deal with that. And then, you know, they try it out. Faith walkers, Pastor Hill, married folks didn't know if they snored or not.
Hallelujah. All right.
But you get to the place of, in this point of where there is a position of getting in God's presence and understanding Him in an intimate way. Beyond being made to. It should be like a release of the cattle and the herd when come to the altar. We should be running to the altar with hands up. But can I tell you what causes that? When you go over to places in Africa and India where they're under persecution and they say come to the altar, they run to the altar. Because they know their very life depends on it. Their very existence depends on how much I can believe God for. How much can you believe God for? What type of credit do you have established in heaven? Come on, somebody, where God can extend and say, I trust you. That's all credit is just trust. Somebody trusts you, then they give you 5,000, and they really trust you, they give you 10. If they don't trust you, they might, you gotta give up some. I'm almost done. So in this message, as I try to conclude, God says that when we please God, so it is by faith, it's faith in God's word, faith in God's plan for your life, God may have the promises of God. The Bible says, are yea and amen.
Amen.
The prophetic words of your life, amen, are yea and amen. Sometimes they get delayed, they get pushed way out there because sometimes we get off the wrong path. The great thing that I love about some of these directional devices that we use, I think I use Google Maps and some of those things, is that it tells you where you're going. And it does not matter if you turn on the wrong street. It knows where you are. Look at the name and say, God knows where you are. The enemy can get you all confused, have you off over in the wrong city. But as long as you listen to the voice coming through your Google Maps in your spiritual ear, he will direct your paths back. The Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. You know, when I go on mine, sometimes if I don't want to pay the price, I'll say, get me where I'm going, but avoid the tolls. Take me where I'm going, but avoid highways. When it's rush hour, I'm not getting nobody's traffic jam in Orlando. I'll take me side streets. I don't care if I'm going through neighborhoods. Just get me. I don't like to sit in traffic. Sometimes, God don't give us our wishes. He takes us there because there's a need that you go that way to learn something. Jesus learned obedience by the things that he suffered, the challenges that he had in his life. This morning, there are individuals in this room, in this church, that have heard this message. And in this message, as I bring this in, there is a direct assignment for your life that the enemy is trying to battle you and stop you. The devil, Satan, our arch enemy, that's trying to stop your progress by causing things to come into your life and get you discouraged and get you all thrown off. I'm telling you, the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Do not look at the situation. You got to tell your enemy that it has no power to stand in front of you. Bible told, or God told the children of Israel, he said that no enemy will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. So as I conclude, I want to just drop this point. Because sometimes the enemy that people are dealing with is not an outside enemy, it's an inside job. So those that are dealing with unforgiveness and things that have happened in their life, or low self-esteem, or all kinds of issues that's in their life, and this happens in the body of Christ, and many times we don't deal with that area. And we deal with those outside things, but many times there are inside things that you have dealt with, of being neglected, being overlooked, being abused, being mistreated. How could God let me be mistreated? Come on. And sometimes people are carrying things from their youth, carrying things from their childhood. And so they're really a grown man, but a little boy inside. A grown woman, but a little girl inside still remembers. Certain things trigger certain reactions. And God is saying that you can address that enemy, come on, today. You can address those enemies today. God don't want you pushing those things off another day. Talking, you know, I'm giving it to Jesus. No, he wants you to get out of that boat and walk on it. Let's stand to our feet this morning. He wants you to deal with those things. We have so many areas of counseling and spiritual counseling that has to go on in the body of Christ, and things that have to be dealt with that have not been really dealt with. Some of these things you can't shout over and dance over. You got to command in the name of Jesus. You will never conquer what you don't confront. Every one of us have things that we have to deal with, that we have to tell in the name of Jesus. I told you before, you're not going to get me this time. And in the name of Jesus, you got to go. And you got to resist, you got to rebuke, and you got to cast out the spirit of the enemy. Cast out those things, that those thoughts. Casting down every imagination that exalts itself against what you know about God's word. This morning, I'm just going to pray before I do a mass prayer, and I want to just, if I can, before I do that, can I just pray for you, Sister Brianna? I heard you do worship before, but there was a different sound this morning in your voice, and some things that you're dealing with in life are pushing you. When I was talking about pregnant, you're pregnant with a project. You're pregnant with a project. And the Lord is saying there's songs that's going to be written in the night. And I don't mean literal light, literal nighttime, but literal tough seasons. Because that's where the great words come from. A promise. So I want to get you to deflect your focus off of where the problem is and look at the joy that's going to come about when somebody hears. Because that's why I start jumping over here and I start crying for a moment. And I was just kind of calm and I heard something in my spirit. Kind of like when Mary and Elizabeth was together. And when at the salutation, the Bible says that the baby jumped in the womb. I felt something. I started to move over here. And the Lord reminded me to speak to you and to prophesy in your life. God's gonna provide all of the resources, going to provide all the money. But the words are coming through challenge. You won't be sitting down at Starbucks writing these words, said God. It's going to be in the middle of the night. We're in the middle of pain or in the middle of a misunderstanding where God said he's going to drop it. He says, keep a pen and a recorder because it's going to be a unique experience that's coming out. And you're going to speak to this millennial generation and bring light, said God. In the name of Jesus, somebody just stand in the name of Jesus. Somebody just pray with me. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Be it done in Jesus' name. Somebody just make a joyful noise right now for her. You're worshiping me. Come on. Ha! Come on, somebody. Somebody should mock the Lord. Hill, I wanted to pray for just speak this to Pastor Moore and Pastor Hill. I don't know where the prayer is now, and I know that you're praying, but I heard God say that because I kept bringing that point out in prayer. But there is an even greater mantle of prayer on this house, on your life. You're known for a lot of things, but you will be known. You will go down as a warrior in prayer. There are going to be people that are going to now begin to come to this church as you open the doors and God tell you and she directs you. There are going to be other churches and pastors and other folks that are going to drop in here just to pray. Because there's some things coming in Tulsa that's going to demand it. And God's going to end you again. And I know you're doing a lot of things, but there's another level. There's a whole other level. See, there is a command center that God establishes that sends out the warriors. And I hear God saying that there is help. Your hands are going to be strengthened. Who is assigned? Who's intercessory prayer warriors? Who? Come here. Just come on. Come over in this corner. Come over in this corner. Because many of y'all are going to pray this message in. God said, you're going to pray this message in. God will speak. But then it's going to be interceded in. Because there's some obstacles that some people have. You got a loosened mind, to cast demonic oppression. Just touch somebody. Everybody just touch them on the shoulder. Everybody just make a point of contact. But your dreams, Pastor Hill, and things that you see in the spirit, they gonna come to pass, God says, in the realm of prayer. Prayer is gonna go to a whole other level. And even the enemy that was buffered you, God is saying the prayers are gonna hold that devil back. It's just taking you all to a whole other level. When the enemy come against your general and fight your man of God, it is a sign and an indication of the enemy trying to stop that next position. And in the name of Jesus, I decree and declare over Northside Christian Center another level of prayer and power and authority in prayer. Greater responsibility. in civic organizations, in city government. I hear God saying in city government, in the police department, that through the prayers and through the words of knowledge and the gifting of the Spirit, God will begin to release words. People won't be there, but names will come forth, said God. And you will come in agreement and begin to decree and declare things that you're seeing and hearing in the Spirit, said God. Great deliverances. Come on, just say great deliverance. One more time, great deliverance. One more time, great deliverance. One more time, great deliverance. In the name of Jesus. Come on, put your hands together and give God praise. I know you do prayer lists probably and put your name on a list, but sometimes we put our name and we really don't have an expectation. But expectation is a breeding ground for miracles. When a person is pregnant, they tell you, I am expecting. They begin to go and buy things in the room, create a room, buy new clothes, because they expect it. And I'm telling this girl, there is a breakout, breakthrough anointing on this group. Come on, y'all need to just celebrate. There's a breakout, breakthrough anointing. Seemingly unbreakable. I want to just agree with you in prayer. Amen. We'll pray in mass. You can just lift up your hands wherever you are. Amen. I see that hand. Yep, just keep it high. I see that hand. Yep, I see those hands. I see those hands all over this place. Amen. If you don't have your hands raised, I just want you to point your hands just in the direction of where. I want you to disagree with me right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for these individuals that are dealing with the enemies, dealing with things that have been buffeting their life, that's challenging, that's delaying, that maybe even dealing with them in their emotions and in their mindset. I pray, God, that as they embrace you and embrace your word and embrace your word and your will, God, that there will be change and swift change in Jesus' name. That they will not leave this place in the same way that they came, but they will make up in their mind that they will run after you, that they will please you, and those enemies will scatter. Those enemies will run, and they will go seven ways in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody give God praise.
Our God, sing with me how great. praise him. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Amen. You may take your seats. I just feel that. Amen. The Spirit of God has just been unleashed in this place. Amen. I just feel that spirit, that breakthrough in the area of, amen, fervency in prayer. Amen. Boy, I'll tell you, amen. How many are ready to go to the next level? Next three levels. Hallelujah. Amen. I just feel that anointing. This morning it just came on me, man. I don't know how many tongues I flowed in this morning, but I was just really broken. I just felt that the anointing to pray, the anointing for God's power to be manifested in this place as never before. Amen. Just like the man of God said this morning. Amen. It is so. Amen. It is so. Y'all don't know the old block, do you? Amen. How many remember his dad? How many of some of the old ones? Amen. A man of God from way back. Amen. Praise God. We're going to have to get him. Amen. In before he gets jealous of his son. All right. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever.
Amen. Families, but yet all across America, churches are packed out with people, amen, trying or attempting to worship God in their own way. Isaiah 55 says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways. For the heavens are higher than earth, so are my ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. The Bible also declares that there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. I heard the woman of God as she was singing this morning, talking about lifting up a hand and surrendering. One of the things that has to happen to please God, amen, along with faith, is a place and a position of surrendering. Surrendering to God, your will, your way, because each season that you go into, there has to be a brand new surrender. Each place, each position, each level. Some people say, I want to go to the next level, but in your next level, there has to be a yes. In your next level, you're going to be faced with temptation. You're going to be